Good morning, Fort Creek Baptist Church. If you're on these front rows, you may be able to stand up and wave to the camera and say hi to our live stream. But if you would stand with us as we begin to worship, please, if you're able.
Myself, and I am glad the Lord has chosen to be with us. The Bible says that He is wherever we gather in the name of Jesus. And so it's here and it's now, and this is the place. Would you listen to God's word in James chapter 4? Beginning in verse 4, James writes, "You adulterous people," he's the old hellfire brimstone preacher for sure. "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us?" It means he wants to be at home in our lives. He wants to be first and on the throne. He wants you to be elevating him so that he can do the maximum work in your life. But you can't have it both ways. You can't go the world's way and go the Lord's way at the same time. It's one or the other. And so here on a Sunday, this needs to be the preeminent place where we declare, "Lord, you are first for me. You are everything to me, and I want to live for you and worship you and bring you great glory." I hope that's your desire. I hope you can say that this morning to him. Let's pray, and then we'll share announcements. We need to pray right off of that. Lord, I give you praise. I thank you that you have done so much for me. You've done so much for us. You died on the cross for our sins. You expressed the desire to be intimate and close to us. You have put your Spirit in each of our hearts as we have confessed the name of Jesus and sought your salvation. We give you praise today. We love you. We express our joy, our delight, our desire is for you. Let this world fade away in our lives. Give us a passion for righteousness, a focus on the word, and a love for your kingdom and your church. Help us to know the deceptions, the tricks, the things the devil's trying to do to us to take us away. Let us worship you with that kind of energy and focus, with deep desire for Jesus to be number one. We pray all this in your name. Amen. I do have a few announcements to share. Wednesday after next, the Voices of Zambia will be here. That is Wednesday night, yes, but that's the only time we could get on their schedule. Please make plans to be here with them. We'll eat about 5:30, 5:45. You need to sign up to eat, and they'll be here then, and then they'll be leading us in a special worship time. I want to let you know, too, that we have positive news in relation to the Good News Club. We're looking at getting back on board in the fall, in September, and so we need help. This is such a powerful ministry in the lives of kids. Many of them have no other exposure to the gospel. They have no awareness of a church or church life or Christians. We need to be in schools where we can tell kids that Jesus loves them and died for them. It is life-changing for these boys and girls, and we need lots of help. It's a real challenge. It's like VBS every week, so there's a lot to do. There's a lot of need. There's a lot of cost, but it is so important. So I want you to be praying about the Good News Club. Speak with Brother Jim to let him know you're willing to help in any way, and there are a lot of different ways for that to happen. I'm going to mention two vacation, I'm sorry, Annie Armstrong. We are in the season for Annie Armstrong. I saw the bids on some of the cakes. We might make our goal today. And if we haven't, get in there and bid on a cake. You can leave right now if you need to for about 30 seconds. Come on back, bid on a cake, and don't bid on the one I bid on. You know, pick a different one, okay? And we're going to have a great day. We have a VBS video, is that right? And then Katie's going to speak.
They want to do it next week, but your schedule's blocked off. Is there anything we can move?
Next week won't work. Let's talk about it at the meeting.
Okay. Here we go.
Have a great day.
Thank you. Oh, hey. All right, you hold down the fort. I'm going to work on that schedule. Thank you.
Marcos, entra, entra.
Hola, jefe. Necesito tomarme la próxima semana libre.
¿Por qué?
I love everything we've got here, but next week isn't going to work for me. Let's push it to the week after. Is that okay? Great.
What's wrong?
I forgot. I have a thing next week.
No, Craig, I have BBS next week. I told you our church does them in the evenings, but...
Your 10:30 is here.
Thanks.
Do you mind me asking? What's so important that you're trying to move this campaign?
Cass got saved at BBS, so it's a really big deal for both of us. We always teach together every summer.
Cuando era niño, tuve una experiencia de salvación en la bebé. Así que ahora cada año en mi iglesia lo trabajo.
Growing up, it was always one of my favorite weeks of the year. I just want to make sure that my kids have the same experience that I did.
That's cool.
Yeah, I think so too.
Could I go too? I loved VBS as a kid.
¿Y qué haces para los dos niños?
Toco la guitarra en el tiempo de adoración.
¿Y los disfrutas?
Es lo mejor.
Bien, voy a orar para que tengan una buena semana.
Gracias, jefe.
Ándale, gracias, Marcos.
All right, y'all can see it's worth it. I'm a little emotional, so you'll have to just bear with me. Lacey and I saw that video at a clinic that we did, and I was like, oh my gosh, we're all like teary-eyed, and it's a very good video. It's worth it. So, I'm gonna get myself together here. So the verse this year is wonderful. It comes from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. It says, we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time for us to do. I didn't see this until this morning. I didn't see this in that verse until this morning. This isn't just for the kids, guys. This is for us. God has already put it in you what you need to do this the week of VBS. He's already given you everything you need to be a volunteer. Because let me tell you, it's not just shuffling kids. It's not just here's your snow cone, here's your popcorn, here's this. You're touching hearts. You're changing lives. Could be for eternity. These are our children. So sorry. Times are dark, guys. We need to give them this. And you need to be here. So I'm not asking you, will you? I'm asking you, where will you help?
Amen.
So there are flyers out there. Excuse me. I'm so sorry, guys. There are flyers out there at VBS cards. Some of them will be in the bulletin. They're going to be at every entryway. Fill it out. Let me know where you're going to help. That's all I'm asking. Let me know where you want to help. I do want to hit up on an announcement that I kind of butchered last week. So we're going to make that a little better right now. We're having an Easter egg hunt on April the 16th at the Deering Walking Track. It's going to be from 2 to 4. We need help with setup, hiding eggs. We want to have some games. We'd like to have somebody painting faces. And we'd like to take our popcorn and snow cone machines. But we can't do it. We can't do it just with the staff. We can't do all of that, so we need you for that too. So I'm hoping that you will today go home and pray and really open yourself up to God and let him speak to you for these great missions that we have right here in our own backyard. We hear all these wonderful missions of overseas and other places, but let's not forget what we have right here. Let's not forget them.
That's right.
And the kids we see in our schools. So thank you.
Thank you, Katie. Church, if you wouldn't mind, please stand if you're able as we continue to worship.
of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saved you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saved you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord.
We crown.
You came to us and set our heart upon the cross. We'll never know the sacrifice you made. For all our sin and all our shame, you took the nails, you took our place. No one else could do what you have done. One name is higher, one name is stronger.
Be with us today and let us learn more about you, Father, and just take your word out into this lost world, Father, and just be a witness for you to whoever we come in contact with, Father. Just let us be bold enough to stand up and speak with people that need to hear your word. Let us share a word with fellow Christians, Father. Just be with each one of us. Keep your holiness upon us. Never let us forget who you are. And I thank you for Jesus Christ and what he did for us on that cross, Father. He brought salvation to the world for those who believe in him and ask for his forgiveness and want them in, or him in their life. Father, I thank you for the time that we are able to give back a portion that you have blessed us with. I ask you just to multiply it and further your kingdom. For us in Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen.
Same old voice, tell the same old lies. You've been trying. there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, save it. Or he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
I could almost sing that again. My goodness. Great stuff. I hope that you sense, know, understand, expect the Spirit's presence here. I know the Spirit's with us as Christians all the time. I know He's trying to do good work, powerful work in our lives all the time. But there is something unique and powerful and overwhelming about the gathering of His people in this place to exalt His name. And I just hope that you know He's here, and you've come to open your heart to what He's trying to do, and you've come to contribute to what He's trying to do. See, we kind of come on the receiving end and on the giving end at the same time. I want to invest in what God's doing. I want to respond as He leads me, but I need all of Him I can get. It's a double-sided deal. So let's just pause before we get into Philippians chapter 3 and pray here. Lord, at this point, we just want to confirm our absolute dependence on You, our great need. We know any problem we can name, you can fix. Any issue we have, you can solve. Any confusion, any direction we need, you provide it. You have a will and a way for our lives. And we are never in the place where we have to be lost or mixed up or standing without an idea of what to do. I pray that you would help us to be totally dependent, completely committed, boldly affirming our love for Jesus. Help us, Lord, in this world that's just gone wacky. Help us to be completely centered on the truth, the absolute truth that solves every problem and leads in every way and brings every joy and every hope if we could just live for you. This is our desire. We know so many people around us who need to have Jesus in their lives. And we pray that we wouldn't just be here because of our need, but as we hear and worship, we would leave this place focused on the needs of other people. We have friends who need to know about the hope that comes from Jesus Christ. We have neighbors who need to hear that there is a God, that he knows what he's doing, and he can help and solve whatever our lives have gotten to. We have people around the world who so badly need to know about Jesus. Help us to be tuned into that. Help us to minister to them. Help us to pray over the needs of other people's lives. And we ask, as we see your word, as we follow your word, that you would let it sink deep into our hearts and we would be completely dependent on you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Philippians chapter 3 is where we are. We started here last Sunday talking about the world's chief religion. The world's chief religion. Have you ever noticed how so many people are enamored with achievement? How so much of the world is driven by status, by success, by desire to be seen and to be elevated and exalted. Chuck Swindoll says it this way: something within all of us warms up to human strokes. We are motivated to do more when our efforts are noticed and rewarded. That is why they make things like impressive trophies and silver platters and bronze plaques and gold medals. Most folks love putting those things on display. Whether it is an athletic letter on a sweater or salesman of the month plaque on the wall, we like the recognition. And what is the result? Recognition drives us for more recognition, more rewards, better pay, higher promotions, more pats on the back. He goes on to write about the categories that we give awards in: scholarships and naming ceremonies and bonuses and trophies and championships and cash prizes and the corner office and the parking place and Oscars and Emmys and Tonys and Grammys. One of those is tonight, I think. Incentivized contracts and awards banquets and banners and plaques and certificates and awe and honor. Personally, I hate the way we adulate and worship the Hollywood types. These people that think they know everything and somehow they're smarter than we are, and somehow too they are in this power position, this recognition position that gives them the right to tell us how we ought to think and act and vote. Well, the truth is there are more of us than there are of them. And if we know God's word, we're not listening to them. And yet still, the world just kind of revolves around this idea of adulation and worship for these power people. I saw a story once of a woman who was visiting in Beverly Hills, and she decided to stop into an ice cream shop. She's going to get a cone of ice cream, and she was standing there doing fine. And then she noticed Paul Newman was standing behind her in the line. And she thought, okay, I'm not going to freak out. Control yourself. It's fine. Be cool. No problem. And she did everything she could to maintain her composure. She bought her ice cream and she kind of turned around for a minute and paused, took a breath. She walked out of the store. Then she started going, where's my ice cream? And she thought, oh, I must have left it on the counter. And she went back inside. She's looking for the ice cream. Can't see it. Finds the tap on the shoulder, and it's Paul Newman, and he says, ma'am, if you're looking for your ice cream cone, you put it in your pocketbook. She really did well there. Achievement has such power over us. It can control and impact us in tremendous ways. But success in this world, achievement by the way the world defines it, never satisfies the soul. This is the amazing thing when we look at the Hollywood types and the rich people and we think, man, I'd love to have that life. But if you look closely at their lives, you see that it's all empty. It's smoke and mirrors. That's why they're looking for more. That's why they never get to a place where they say, this is enough. I've made it. Everything is fine. They are driven for more. That's also why drugs and alcohol are consuming that world, because they still don't find any satisfaction. So it's a hard fact for people to learn. They're chasing this elusive prize that the world cannot satisfy. The prize is peace and contentment and joy and fulfillment and satisfaction and hope and eternal life. Those are issues of the soul, and the issues of the flesh never feed the soul. So we've got to be able to see where they come from. This is why the world has manufactured religion. Every religion in the world is made up. It's manufactured to try and find some way through human power, human means, to satisfy what's really the deeper, life-changing issues that no religion can ever satisfy. And yes, I said that correctly. No religion. Christianity is not a religion. Christianity is God's answer to the problems of your soul. And it's the only hope that this world has, the only hope. No religion can answer the questions. Religion is based on the ultimate, the world's chief religion, which is humanism. We could call it secularism. They talk about that in the world a lot, as if that's something to uphold and exalt and trust in and accomplish. All you're doing is accomplishing failure and emptiness if your goal is to make this world a secular world. That's Satan's goal. That's what he wants to accomplish. And when all those people get to hell that put their trust in humanism, that's what they'll still be talking about. I thought this would work. I thought this was the answer. I thought I was okay. I thought I had made it. They want to do something to finally feel good about themselves. They want to make all the pain and all the questions go away. They're trying to fulfill the desire that God has implanted within each person. God's the creator, and he's established this desire to find him, to seek him, to know him, to understand him, to love him. But you can never get there by any other way than through Jesus Christ. So this is the world's chief religion. We called it me-ism last time because that's what it becomes. All about me. Here we are then in Philippians 3. And Paul says, "Further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again. And it is a safeguard to you. Watch out for those..." We could put here humanists, okay? Those me-ism world religion experts, he calls them dogs and evildoers and mutilators of the flesh, which is, he's getting into the specific issue with a specific group of people. They followed him around and they tried to undermine the gospel everywhere he went. So Paul would go into a town, he would plant a church, he would establish for them the absolute once for all gospel. Jesus died for you because you couldn't meet your need. He died for you because you are a sinner and there's no other hope than the blood of Christ. So Jesus is your substitute. He paid the price for your sins. Now you can have a relationship with God and you can know him, and it's completely about him and none about you. Well, the Judaizers would come in after that, and you can hear the name there. They are exalting Judaism, the Old Testament, and they would say, yes, Jesus is the Messiah. Yes, you need Jesus, but there's also this list of things you have to do. Circumcision was the main one. It was the visible, the symbolic action that had to be undertaken. And so Paul says, all you're doing is mutilating yourself. You're not earning any points from God this way. That is not how it works. And he goes on to say, it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. There's your definition of humanism. Though I myself would have reasons for such confidence, if anyone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. If you Judaizers think you're all that and you've got it all together and God ought to be impressed with you, I have you beat on every count. If this is what you're trusting in, here's what you need to know about me. I was circumcised on the eighth day. I am of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. In regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness based on the law, I was faultless. Paul is establishing his religious resume, and he's kind of building stair steps up to, if anybody could get to God this way, it would have been me. I had it all together according to the world's definitions. Now let's review this just a little bit from last time, and that we can look at what else is here. There's a lot here. I understand that. We're going to do justice to this text. It's here for a reason. And we need to understand every bit of the nuance of what the scriptures are saying to us this morning. This is as personal and intimate as it can get. When we look at the list, you'll see somebody you know. And I would strongly recommend that you find yourself somewhere in the list. That's the challenge that we have to face and deal with and get rid of. So he says they were dogs, which means they are unsaved. He said they are men who do evil, which is God's label for their religion. Please don't miss this. You are religious. You think you have upheld the law. But the fact is, you are the ones who are living evil lives. This is God's estimation of all religion. Are you listening to me this morning? There are a lot of people in our world today, and they'll tell you all religions are virtually the same. They talk about the same stuff. It is true they talk about the same stuff because they're trying to satisfy the same needs. Obviously, they're going to have the same kind of conversations. But the only one that gets to the solution is the Word of God and the truth of Jesus Christ. Anything else is human effort. Then he says they are mutilators of the flesh, which is about the physical act of circumcision. Since you are trusting in it, it is actually nothing more than self-abuse. It's not salvation, it is just injury. And then he says in verse 3, we are covenant believers. It is we who are the circumcision, meaning the true circumcision, the true believers in Jesus Christ. We are the ones who have placed our faith in Christ, and only Christ can accomplish what circumcision cannot accomplish. Romans 2, 28 and 29 says it this way. A man is not a Jew if he is only one outwardly. And he makes the reference then to circumcision. Nor is circumcision merely outward and physical. That's what they were trusting in. But he says, no, a man is a Jew if he is one inwardly. It's about the heart, about the soul. And circumcision is circumcision of the heart by the Spirit, not by the rules and regulations, the written code. Such a man's praise is not from men, but from God. Do you hear the Paul Newman story there? Such a man's praise is not from men. If you're living in that way, following the world's pattern, the best you can get is the pat on the back, the attaboy, you're a good person. And the world might just give you everything that you think you need, and it won't meet any needs at all. It won't do anything for you. So the heart of the issue is the issue of the heart. Do you follow Christ by religious actions and practices, or do you follow Christ by having received Him in your heart for your salvation? We are the covenant believers. And then he says, we are the Spirit-initiated believers. We who worship by the Spirit of God. The other option is self-initiated. I did this. I worked. I kept the law. I'm a good person. I have worked hard to earn my way. Which is to say, there's nothing that we can do to earn our way. That means really we have to even be careful when we say, I accepted Christ, I came to faith in Christ, I put my trust in Christ, I got saved. Or one of the things that really bothers me is when somebody says, I led old so-and-so to the Lord. No, you didn't. Okay? No, you didn't. The Spirit is responsible for all of it. You didn't even place your faith in Christ. The Spirit enabled you with the capacity to believe and nudged you in the direction to faith until you finally surrendered to that. If you really can have confidence in yourself, you're going right back into humanism, something I did. The fact is that Christ accepted me, the Spirit supplied me with faith, and the Lord saved me. That's the only way to say it. We are Spirit-initiated believers. We are then gospel-focused believers. It says in the text, we glory in Christ Jesus. Karl Barth said, the gospel is not a truth among other truths. Rather, it sets a question mark against all truths. Do you know what it means to glory in Christ Jesus? It means that you get to the place, just as a foundational truth, where you understand that Jesus is all you've got. And that Jesus is all you need. And you're able to say, He saved me. I didn't deserve it. I'm not worthy of it. I didn't do anything to earn it. I don't even understand why He would love me enough to do this work in my life. But He did it. He did it. He did it. And I give Him the glory. I exalt His name. I praise Him and worship Him. Now, that's supposed to be easy to do for Christians. Right? Supposed to be easy to do. We are the ones who glory in the Spirit of Christ. And yet so often we get distracted. We let the world get us down. We look at somebody who looks like they have everything and think we want that stuff. We look around at things we don't like. Hello, Sunday morning crowd. You ever heard of anybody at any church in any time talk about something they didn't like? You need to just leave that stuff in the ditch, okay? The devil's working to show you stuff you don't like. And by the way, you can always find something you don't like. In any church, on any Sunday morning, you'll find something you don't like if you want to. If we're going to glory in Christ Jesus, none of that even matters. Anyway, somehow, in this place, with these people, I'm going to find Jesus. And I'm going to center my soul there. And I'm going to give Him all the glory I'm capable of giving Him. Number four in this text, we are the self-repudiating believers. We put no confidence in the flesh. I don't trust in my ability. I don't think in any way that I can save myself, that I've earned anything, that I deserve anything, that I'm better than anybody else. I am not going to heaven expecting to show God my resume. He's not going to ask when I was baptized or how much I gave or if I was a good person. None of that. Even like I mentioned last Sunday, that question that we've used to introduce the gospel to people. If you died and stood before the Lord and He asked you, why should I let you into my kingdom? What would you say? He's not going to ask you that question, okay? He's going to say, welcome home. Good to see you. And the reason He's going to say that is because when He sees you, He sees His Son. You, as a believer in Jesus, are consumed with the righteousness of Christ. That's a hard thing for us to grasp because there's a little bit of unrighteousness in there too. But we've got to be able to understand the self didn't make me. The self has done everything it can to mess me up, to confuse me and just destroy the things that are most important. So I'm not trusting in any way in the flesh. And so Paul makes this comparison. He says first, they are, and then he says, we are. They are in the flesh. They are serving the world. We are of the Spirit, and we are the ones that are truly saved. And then he says, however, if you really still think that you can earn your way, that somehow you're better than anybody else and you deserve God and nobody else does, let me tell you something about the way I used to think. That's what he's getting ready to do. This is Paul's spiritual resume, and it is stellar. We might say today that Paul was the greatest Christian that ever lived. We read his writings. There's a reason why he's responsible for more of the New Testament than any other writer. Yes, Paul, we can learn so much from and idealize and follow his example. And yet, if you look at Paul before he became a Christian, that was the same deal in Judaism. as a man following the law, he was at the top of the heap. And that's what he's expressing. If anybody could keep the law, I am the one who did so. So he lists all of his pre-Christian humanistic accomplishments. It is the ultimate religious resume. Let's go through this list. You will be in here somewhere. In one of these, the Holy Spirit is going to press a button in your heart. He's going to scratch a point when you're going to say, yeah, that's an issue I need to deal with. That's an issue where I've put confidence in myself rather than in the Spirit. Let's look at these. First, he says that I was religious from the start. Circumcised on the eighth day, which means when I was 8 days old, my parents followed the letter of the law, took me to the place to be circumcised. I've been doing this all along. I've been keeping the rules from the beginning. Today, somebody will say, I was baptized all the way, or the pastor held me down long enough to make sure it took. You ever heard anybody say that? I'm baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and we're going to make sure you get on. It happens to you. We put our faith in that kind of experience. Have you heard anybody say, I was coming to church 9 months before I was born? Now, I know that's just a silly statement, a funny thing to say, but sometimes people do elevate themselves based on when they started with Jesus or how long they've been a Christian or how they started. I've been a Christian longer than you've been born. And you know what my answer is? Big, fat, whoop-dee-doo. What difference does that make? I know some people who will say they've been Christians all their lives, but they don't look too Christian to me. You know what I mean? I know lots of people who talk about being Christians and hadn't darkened the door of a church in decades. It's pretty hard for you to justify your love for Jesus if you don't love what Jesus loves. Okay, and you don't want to be around the people of God. What do you think it's going to be like in heaven? You'll be miserable. Come on. So we've got to be able to even recognize that the mentality we have right from the beginning, did we elevate ourselves like we somehow are better than anybody else because of the length of time? He says, next, I am part of the in crowd of the people of Israel. He's highlighting the spiritual arrogance of many Israelites in the first century. We are the people of God. You can see instance after instance in the Old Testament where judgment is pronounced by a prophet and the people answer, not us. That's not going to happen to us. We are the people of God. We are Israel. And then judgment after judgment after judgment happens again and again and again. Today, we could put some kind of hope in our denomination. You know, I'm old-fashioned Baptist. I'm a good old Baptist. Or our big church, or our upbringing, as if we have some kind of favored status because we have a connection to something in the past. He says, next, I am of the tribe of Benjamin, which means I'm at the head of my class. Benjamin was one of the favored tribes. They produced the first king. They were the only tribe to stay faithful in the division. They stayed with the tribe of Judah and remained faithful to the covenant, and it was a point of serious pride. Today, we can point to an influential church or some connection we had. I grew up in this way, or I was in this church, or I knew this person, or my daddy was a deacon or a preacher or a Sunday school teacher. It's just another way we might point to some type of status, some type of identification. We'll say something like, I learned all of that in first grade Sunday school. Well, good for you. Put it into practice. Why don't you? Live it out if that's the case. Don't trust in it. Be it. I'm at the head of my class. Number four, he says, I am ethnically pure, a Hebrew of Hebrews. You're trying to get these Philippians to be identified with the Jewish nation. That's what the Judaizers wanted. You have to look like a Jew. Have Jesus, but look like a Jew. Be circumcised. And Paul is saying, you know, I was the Jew of Jews. Now, most scholars will tell you this is probably a reference to the fact that Paul could speak the Hebrew language, which was very uncommon in this day. Only the most revered Jews would be able to speak Hebrew, the scholars of the day. And most of the people, the language of the street was Aramaic. Today you could hear somebody say, I was brought up in the Bible Belt. I was raised Southern Baptist. Or here's one, think about this. King James only for me. You others, you can read your simplistic Bibles. I'm not even sure you're really saved. I'm a King James man. Do you hear the pride point there? Like somehow you're better than because of whatever translation you choose to use. Now, I'm not against King James. Don't hear me say that. Use the translation that you're comfortable with, but don't somehow decide that it's better than anything and everything else. This is the category Paul is talking about. I'm in this place where what I do or the way I do it is somehow elevating me. Number five, I am active in my church. That's the statement he makes in regard to the law of Pharisee. In regard to the law of Pharisee, which would make the first century Jew go, ooh, wow, did you hear that? Man. That's what they thought of the Pharisees. They elevated them to the highest place. They had ultimate respect for them. They were in a religious class all by themselves. Today, you'll hear Christians say, I'm at church every time the doors are open. What's that done for you? Has that worked in your life? Is that what you're trusting in? You checking off a list somehow to get the numbers where they need to be? Or we'll think, I lead this committee. Or I'm really important in this way. I perform that ministry. I've always got something to do. I've known some people in church circles where they glory just in the fact that they're tired all the time. You know, I run after this and I'm on that and I got this meeting and I got to be here. Whew, I'm serving the Lord every chance I get. Sounds like a little personal pride in there. We can even take pride in that. We've got to be careful. I think I've said to you before, in my ministry, I've had two instances where somebody said to me, this church wouldn't make it without me. Both times, I wanted to back away from them. I thought it was going to be a lightning bolt in a greasy spot right there in front of me. Do you know what that means? This church don't need Jesus. It needs me. That's the ultimate pride. By the way, when they left, we made it just fine without them. Both times. In fact, it was better without them, can I just say? Active in my church, and then he says passionate. Number six, as for zeal, persecuting the church. Today, I just love the Lord. I'm on fire for Jesus. Jesus is the only thing I care about. Now, I hope that's true. Please, to God, let that be true and express it. But the problem is, those people who express it the most, they just make you wonder, right? If they have to say it enough, why do they have to keep saying it? Are they trying to prove it to themselves? Are they trying to prove it to you? Are they trying to build attention for themselves? It's just a point of caution. We have to always be careful. What is the motive? What is the thought? Why is this happening in my mind, in my heart? Am I trying to elevate myself? To look good in these people's eyes? Am I trying to look good in my own eyes? Do I think somehow God's going to like me better because of the things that I do? The real question then, if you're so passionate in front of people, are you just as passionate when you're by yourself? Nobody's watching. Nobody's going to be able to pat you on the back or give you the attaboy. Nobody's going to love you more because of this thing you're doing. Are you passionate then? This is why back in Matthew 6, Jesus talks about don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. That's the point of a guard. You have to set a guard over your heart so that if you're serving with one hand, you don't even want the other hand to know about it. Because as soon as there's any chance of recognition, it goes straight to the flesh every time. So you got to be so careful. Don't draw attention to yourself. Paul saying, if anybody had the zeal that was visible, it was me. I was the guy going to cities in the next state over to take Christians to prison. And I think we don't make as big a deal of this as we ought to. And Paul terrorized Christians. He murdered Christians. Do you understand? That's what they were doing, and he was in charge of it. As passionate for Jesus as we are, also, are you as passionate for Jesus as you are for your ball team? Or for your new fishing rod you just got? Your passion for Jesus equal that? I don't hear any amens now, right? Like the King James comment I made. Boy, it was deathly silence then. Y'all with me? We're okay? Ladies, you have as much passion for Jesus as the next Hallmark movie? When Christmas in July gets here and they flood the channels with all these heartwarmings and we have Hallmark parties. Jesus stir you any more than that? Or for whoever your boyfriend is, if you're not married, you know, you got to have the passion where it's supposed to be. Number 7, doctrinally precise. As for legalistic righteousness, faultless. Paul says, if anybody could keep the law, it was me. Today somebody says, I know my Bible. I read it every day. I do what the Bible says. You know, you can know a great deal about God's Word and still not know the one who wrote God's Word. Do you know that? Guys, I've been to seminary and I've heard some professors who are deep scholars of the Word of God, and I wondered if they were saved or not. They can teach it, but they don't feel it. You can see either they've gotten in a rut or there's something more going on in their life. Anybody in any church can be victim to that. So yes, we want to infatuate ourselves with the Word of God and let it seep into our lives. We want to know the Word. We want to know the law. We want to know grace. We want to live it out. But we've got to make sure that that is not what elevates us. All of this, Paul says, adds up to the Christian humanist manifesto. I was this. I was that. I accomplished this. I am. And there's that magic word. And all we're doing is bringing the focus and the attention back to ourselves. I'm telling you, for the believer who comes to church, this is the most dangerous thing in your life. Do you hear me? This is the most dangerous thing. And everywhere the Scripture talks about complainers and grumblers and those who love the Word and those who are not faithful and don't persevere. Everywhere the Scripture talks about believers with this problem or this problem or this problem. It all goes back to the issue we're talking about this morning. You're letting the flesh take over when you start trusting in yourself or elevating yourself or glorying in your own self. And it's so, so dangerous. And he gives us, kind of seasoned within the passage, some concluding statements. They're not at the end, but I want to make them just as conclusions. Here's what we should do. Number one is in verse 1. We should be Christ-centered. Rejoice in the Lord, he says in verse 1. Isn't that great? He starts talking about legalism with that phrase, rejoice in the Lord. He starts with an emotional plea, a feeling kind of plea, an energetic. Get yourself clued into Jesus and feel it and know it and love him. And then he talks about all of these rules-based mindsets. He's really saying you should focus your worship and your energy on the things of God. Focus your worship and your energy on who Christ is. He's the only thing that matters. He's the only hope that you've got. He is the only one who is worthy of praise and honor and glory. And I mean all of your praise and all of your honor and all of your glory. Number 2, he says, be careful. Be careful. Verse 2, that phrase is, watch out. This is not just a, hey, watch out for the hole over there. This is, look out, stop, don't go there. Bridge out. You're going over the cliff. You're in danger. Watch out for the dogs. If you get yourself associated with this way of thinking, this is the me trap, and it'll mess up your spiritual life like nothing else. It'll sever your bond with the Lord. Now, you won't be lost. I'm not saying that. It'll just separate you from a meaningful, life-changing, daily walk with the Lord. And you'll sit in your own little circle worshiping yourself. That's what it leads to. And wondering why everybody else isn't worshiping you too. What a horrible, empty life that is. It is a strong warning. So you evaluate what you hear and who you are with Scripture. Number three, be honest. He says in verse 3, we put no confidence in the flesh. This is the test. You're always telling yourself the truth about yourself. My life's all about Jesus. The only reason I'm here is Jesus. The only thing I deserve is hell. Can you say that to yourself? Do you understand that's the truth about you and me and every other person except the Lord Jesus who ever walked on this planet? The only thing we deserve is judgment and hell. That's it. And everything you might put on a list of all your abilities and accomplishments, judgment and hell. We've got to be able to be honest. We put no confidence in the flesh. We have to guard ourselves against the threat of religion. We have to be able to tell anybody when somebody says to you, oh, all religions are the same, your answer is yes, they are. Yes, they are. And every religion leads you straight to despair and sorrow and hell every single time. That'll shock them because they think Christianity, when they say all religions, they're putting Christianity in there too. You tell them, yes, all religions are empty and worthless. What you need is a relationship with Jesus Christ. He's the one who died for your sins. He is the Son of God who made you and designed you and has a plan for your life like nothing else you could ever come up with. But we can't put our faith in whatever the world is offering. This religion thing, it'll mess you up so fast. So be warned, be careful, listen. Ask the Spirit, let me hear when I drift into this area. When I start feeling good about my own accomplishments in an unhealthy way, when I start comparing myself to somebody else and I somehow can decide I'm better than them, God deserves me. Ooh, that's scary stuff, guys. Be careful, be careful. Let's pray. Lord, in this place and this time, we ask for a gut check. We ask that you'd come bold and true to us. We hope and intend that you've already done that in how we've looked at your word. But now make it just what it needs to be for each person sitting here, each person that's watching us online, to be able to do the self-evaluation. Where have I put confidence in myself? Where have I exalted myself? Where have I sought my own glory or thought I was something that I really am not? Lord, I pray that we'd be able to go the next step and declare without equivocation, all my hope is in Christ. He is everything, and He is making something good in my life. Lord, we love you. Help us to see the truth about ourselves. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I hope the challenge is plain to you. I don't have to even say it again. Let the Lord direct your understanding, how you think and how you focus and where your mindset and your attitude is about you, and so that you're able to just back away and say, all my glory is in Christ. All my love is for Him. All of my need, all of my determination about tomorrow, it's about Jesus. Let Him speak that in your life. If you don't know Him, oh, friends, you've got to fix that. You need to fix it right here, right now, today. You have to simply say, I can't do this on my own. I am a total failure. I want Jesus. I know what He's done for me. Come into my heart, Lord. Forgive me of my sins and save me. That's what you need to say. Say it this morning. But I'm going to ask you during this time, come and say it to me. Let me help you and pray with you at that point in your life. If you need to be saved, don't leave here today without it. Go ahead, let's stand together. Going to sing, but you respond how the Lord leads you today.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness. I'm new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. could remember no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
I hope on any Sunday when you leave a church experience that what has happened is working on you. It works on me, I promise you. I hope the Spirit is at you, that he's talking to you, that he's challenging you. Every single one of us need to be challenged. And if the Lord's in your heart, every single one of us needs to be affirmed. And the Lord will do that. He'll work in both of those directions in your life. If he's not in your life, you need him so badly. We're available to talk to you, Brother Jim, Chris, anybody else in this church supposed to be able to talk to you about what it means to have a relationship with Jesus. They can tell you their story, and you can see how it works. But you need to take that step. We're going to be back this evening. I hope you'll come tonight and be able to join us. We're going to talk about what happens to your old body when you die. What happens? And where do we go from there? It's going to be good stuff in 1 Corinthians 15. Hope you'll come at 6. And then, of course, youth and children are starting out at 5 o'clock. Let's pray together. We'll be dismissed. Kevin, close us, please.